Welcome to worship in Advent. I'm Pastor Joe. It's a blessing to be here with you this week as we begin this season of Advent, longing, waiting, expectantly looking for Christ to come, and which does indeed happen in the form of a child on Christmas Eve. A few announcements as we enter into this Advent season. We will be having an Advent midweek offering. Those will come in more of the form of a meditation this week and will be available to you on Wednesday mornings through our YouTube channel. As we look forward to our Christmas services this year, we will most certainly be offering an online Christmas worship, and we hope that there can be more. Stay tuned in the coming weeks for more information on that. And then as we journey through Advent, even though we may be socially distanced, we can be together in reading our Advent devotional. A huge thanks to the Prayer Project for putting that together, and we pray that as you leave through those pages, as you read through them, as you meditate on them, that God speaks to you through the stories of our members. If you did not get an Advent devotional, please reach out to the church office and we will be sure to get you one. With that, we turn our hearts and minds to worship as we begin our service with our Advent litany. As Sarah waited 90 years for a son to fulfill God's promise,
we wait in hope for what has been spoken to us.
As Moses waited 40 years in the desert, being prepared by God to lead his people,
we wait for patience and humility for God to work in us.
As the prophets waited 1,000 years of promises that God would raise up a Savior,
we wait for the signs that God has not forgot.
As Mary waited 9 months for the child of God,
we feel the birth pains, yet fear for the child.
As John the Baptist waited, scanning the crowds for the one whose sandals he would not be worthy to untie,
we long for an experience of the divine.
So we wait for God's time, our turn to prepare the way, our turn to watch the horizon, our turn to pass on the hope that he who promised is faithful and will return. Amen. As we move into a time of lighting our Advent candle, we have a treat for you this year. Over the course of the next 4 weeks in Advent, our Director of Children and Family Ministries, Kayla File, has put together Advent wreath kits. And so during our worship, we will be having some of our families lighting their Advent wreaths at home and sharing in a prayer with you.
We praise you, O God, for this evergreen crown that marks our days of preparation for Christ's Advent. As we light the first candle on this wreath, rouse us from sleep that we may be ready to greet our Lord when he comes with all the saints and angels. Enlighten us with your grace and prepare our hearts to welcome him with joy. Grant this through Christ our Lord, whose coming is certain and whose day draws near. Amen.
Thank you.
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Stir up your power, Lord Christ, and come. By your merciful protection, awaken us to the threatening danger of our sin, and keep us blameless until the coming of your new day, for you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
A reading from Isaiah. Oh, that you would tear open the heavens and come down, so that the mountains would quake at your presence, as when fire kindles brushwood, and the fire causes water to boil. To make your name known to your adversaries, so that nations might tremble at your presence. When you did awesome deeds that we did not expect, you came down. The mountains quaked at your presence. From ages past, no one has heard, no ear has persevered. No eye has seen any God besides you, who works for those who wait for him. You meet those who gladly do right, those who remember you in your ways, but you were angry and we sinned, because you hid yourself and we transgressed. We have all become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous deeds are like a filthy cloth. We all fade like a leaf, and our iniquities, like the wind, take us away. There is no one who calls on your name or attempts to take hold of you, for you have hidden your face from us and have delivered us into the hand of our iniquity. Yet, O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay, and you are our potter. We are all the work of your hand. Do not be exceedingly angry, O Lord, and do not remember iniquity forever. Now consider, we are all your people. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel according to Mark.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said, in those days after that suffering, the sun will be darkened and the moon will not give its light, and the stars will be falling from heaven, and the powers in the heavens will be shaken. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory. Then he will send out the angels and gather his elect from the four winds and from the ends of the earth to the ends of heaven. From the fig tree, learn its lesson. As soon as its branch becomes tender and puts forth its leaves, you know that summer is near. So also, when you see these things taking place, you know that he is near at the very gates. Truly I tell you, this generation will not pass away until all these things have taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. But about that day or hour, no one knows, neither the angels in heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. Beware, keep alert, for you do not know when the time will come. It is like a man going on a journey. When he leaves home and puts his slaves in charge, each with his work, and commands the doorkeeper to be on the watch. Therefore, keep awake, for you do not know when the master of the house will come in the evening or at midnight or at cockcrow or at dawn, or else he may find you asleep when he comes suddenly. And what I say to you, I say to all. Keep awake. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
We recently left town for a couple days to clear our heads and get some rest before the holidays come, before COVID case numbers get any worse. In that time we were away, our Christmas cactus bloomed. Now we've had this plant for years, and occasionally it sprouts a bloom here and there around the holidays, but this year it really popped. I didn't notice it. It sits right beside the TV. I mean, I'm sure I looked at it many times after we came home. I sit directly across from it and turn a little to look at the TV. I didn't notice the bloom until my wife, Christine, pointed them out to me. Clearly, I'm not the horticultural one in the family. Don't leave me in charge of watering and caring for your plants. So, when I read some of Jesus' words in our gospel from Mark today, I got a little nervous. He says right in the middle of the passage, learn the lesson from the fig tree. As soon as the branches become tender and the leaves come out, you know summer is near. Good thing for me, they've invented calendars since then to tell me when summer's coming, because I can guarantee you, I would not notice the fig tree's branches getting tender. So if the fig tree was my only teacher, I'd miss it. If that was the sign of Jesus' return to earth, I'd be a goner. But fortunately, for my lack of awareness around all things flora, there's more to this passage. Let's unearth it a little more. The gospel begins with the suggestion that great suffering is going to happen. And indeed, if you go back and look at the beginning of chapter 13 in Mark, Jesus warns of the destruction of the temple and great persecution of believers, including something called the desolating sacrilege. Oh, is that all? Anyways, after all that suffering, signs will appear in the sky. The sun will go dark. The moon won't have light to shine. The stars will fall from heaven. I hope that even with my lackadaisical skills of observation, I would notice that. This is the sign that the Son of Man is coming on the clouds with great power and glory. And after all this suffering that's been foretold, that is something to look forward to. Should we start looking for those signs now? There is great suffering in this world, made even worse by COVID-19. Over 250,000 people have died in this country alone. Loss of jobs due to COVID is leading to huge amounts of food insecurity, and institutions that we considered as unshakable as the temple in Jerusalem have floundered, if not outright fallen. The arrival of a Messiah coming on the clouds would be a welcome sight for our weary world. But Jesus goes on. After the bit about the fig tree, Jesus admits that as he currently is, even though he's God in human form, he does not know when that day is coming. The verse says, about that day or hour, no one knows, neither the angels in heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. It's pointless to look for those signs, to watch for the great suffering, to predict the coming at the end, because Jesus says, I don't even know when that's happening. So, what do you do instead of trying to figure out when that day is coming? Keep awake. Jesus says this three times over the span of five verses, so you know it's important. In verse 33, beware, keep alert. In verse 35, therefore, keep awake. And in verse 37, and what I say to you, I say to all, keep awake. If you can't predict the end, at least be ready for it by staying awake all the time. Well, I don't know how long any of you have stayed up at one time before. I don't know what kind of sleepless nights you've endured. I can't speak to the effect that the monotony of this COVID time is having on you, but I know this about me. The longer I stay awake, the less alert I am. The more hyper-focused I try to be on one thing, the less I notice anything and everything else. I mean, I'm hard-pressed to notice flowers blooming right in front of my face when I'm fully rested and awake with a coffee. If I'm worn down from staying awake all the time, I may not even notice if the plant has withered and died and fallen on the floor. Staying awake and alert, staying vigilant all the time, it's exhausting, it's draining, and I believe it actually prevents us from noticing the subtleties and the changes in the world around us. I believe it's harmful to the wholeness of our lives as Christians. I fear that Jesus' charge to stay awake has been taken and interpreted to mean Never let your guard down. Always watch yourself. If you slip up at any moment, if you sin for just an instant, it could be at that moment that Jesus returns, and won't you be sorry then? Keep awake has come to mean focusing all your energy looking for the sign that might not even be apparent to you when it does show up, and all that energy being focused on the singular goal of watching our behavior to make sure we're ready at any time means we're too exhausted to do anything else. I don't believe that's what Jesus intended. Yes, we should prepare for the coming of the Son of Man. This season of Advent highlights that. Over these next 4 weeks leading up to Christ's birth among us on Christmas, the church slows down. Our music shifts into minor keys. We read stories and lessons about the ones who proclaimed Christ's coming. We watch and we wait. Perhaps this year with more intensity than any other. But our watching and waiting for Christ isn't just staring at the leaves of a fig tree, waiting for the leaves to shoot forth. Watching and waiting for Christ means being active in this world and living a full life with faith at the center of it. It's about loving God and loving others the best we can, knowing sometimes that's not good enough. Sometimes we mess it up. It's about enjoying the good things God has given us here while still living in the hope that there's more good things that will come along with Jesus on those clouds descending. It's about acknowledging Jesus' sacrifice for us and going and doing likewise, bringing justice to places we rather might not go. But I also believe it means getting the rest we need to rejuvenate ourselves for the time we are awake. Rest by taking time for the things and the ones we love, finding ways to fill our hearts with joy. Rest is needed so we don't wander through our days awake, but lifeless. And in the midst of that rest, if we let our guard down, if we do fall asleep, if we aren't quite awake and aware enough all the time, we heard in the parable of the bridesmaids in Matthew 25 a few weeks back, all the bridesmaids fell asleep. None were able to stay awake the whole time. And yet 5 of them were still considered wise because in the time that they were awake, they had lived in the preparation of the time to come. None of us know when Christ will come again. Most of us will be like me and my Christmas cactus and completely oblivious of its blooming until it's already upon us. If not even Jesus could tell when the end was coming, it's surely not up to us to expend our precious time and energy to try and wait for it, to control ourselves that we never slip up. So, when you are awake, prepare. Prepare in ways that strengthen your faith and ways that love your neighbor, but be sure to rest too in whatever way you need. You can't catch it all, even if sometimes it's right in front of your face. But like the bridesmaids in the parable, when God finds you resting, God will wake you up and he will call you home. Amen. God of power and might, tear open the heavens and come quickly to this weary world. Hear our prayers for everyone in need. We pray for the ministry we share in Christ's name. Open our hearts to your call for justice, peace, and healing. Attune us to the needs of the world as you draw near. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for this planet in need of restoration, for devastated habitats, polluted waters, thawing ice, blazing fires, and long-lasting droughts. Renew the face of the earth and our relationship to it. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for all people who care for others in our community and around the world. Fill them with compassion and the power to respond with justice for those who are oppressed, with welcome for those who are excluded, and with relief for those who suffer. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for people who are in crisis as the seasons change, for those without homes facing severe weather, for those who are unemployed or underemployed, and for those in poverty or facing food insecurity. Relieve their burdens, sustain their bodies, and ease their minds. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for the people in our families and congregation who live with any form of mental illness, depression, anxiety, chronic pain, addiction, and all other invisible illnesses we name before you in our hearts now. Ease their suffering and support them when they struggle. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We give thanks for the lives and witness of those who died while waiting for justice, peace, or healing, those whose names we know and those whose names are known only to you. Sustain all who still yearn for the completion of your redeeming work. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Draw near to us, O God, and receive our prayers for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. As we turn to God's table and prepare for communion, I invite you to find your communion kit or other elements. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Exalted is your name, Lord God, for you created all things. By your grace you wash away our sin and make us new. We remember how on the night before he died, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." Great is the mystery of faith we proclaim together. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Send down your Holy Spirit on your people to work for your kingdom of justice and peace. Sanctify this bread and cup before us, that they become the body and blood of your Son. Great is your faithfulness, Holy God. Draw us together with all people and make us one with you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, who taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. I invite you to take out the bread and hold it up. This is the body of Christ given for you. and then do the same with the cup. This is the blood of Christ shed for you. Hear now these words of blessing. May God, who gathers us in love, lead you in pathways of righteousness and justice. May God, who knows us more deeply than we know ourselves, lead you in pathways of forgiveness and freedom. May God, who fills us with good things, lead you in pathways of equity and abundance. The blessing of the Holy Trinity, one God, be upon you and remain with you forever. Amen. Go in peace. Wait for the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Strong to